Today we are celebrating the opening of the Sahasrara on this day. I must say it was a great happening that took place for all the humanity. It was such an achievement which I never realized before. Now I can see that without self-realization, it would have been impossible to talk to people. When this happened, I thought that how will I talk to people about it, because no one would understand me. It would be a big mistake on my part to say something about Sahasrara because even about Sahasrara, nowhere in the scriptures some things were described. It was absolutely a ambiguous description, I would say, where people could not have even thought that there is a realm beyond Sahasrara. And one has to enter into that realm where is the reality. That time what I saw around me, I felt it's all darkness, and unless and until there are many lights, people will never realize that how important it is to have lights. It is a human error also all the time that if somebody achieves something, then they put that person onto a shelf. For example, Christ, all right, he was Christ, we are not Christ. Muhammad Sahib, he was Muhammad Sahib, we are not Muhammad Sahib. Rama was Rama, Krishna was Krishna. We are not that. How can you expect human beings to behave like them? So, absolutely they are separated. The divine personalities away, very much away from human personality. It was just a adoration, I can say, faith. But when they said we try to follow them, they could not. They could not follow them. Because I think human movement is on parallel lines with the divine. And these lines do not meet. Unless and until you give them self-realization. Human level is moving on another plane, and it has to come up to a higher plane to understand that what they know is not reality. I wouldn't say what is needed for that. Because in my own experience, all kinds of people came to Sahasrara. There are people described to be very bad, cruel, another ones who were very licentious, this, that, then another ones who were cheats, and they said, Mother, they are horrible people. But I've seen that every human being is as if made of the same character as far as the spirit is concerned. Outside they may be different to look at. Their way of talking may be different. Their styles may be different. Their fondness for things may be different. But inside they are all very beautiful. And this I found out one after another. You don't know how much it was giving me joy, not only joy but also encouragement, support and patience. And then now you see how Sahaj Yoga has grown. The greatest thing has now happened is, which I realize, I'm very happy about it, that Sahaj Yogis feel very responsible about Sahaj Yoga. And they feel that they have to spread this enlightenment everywhere. It's their innate desire now to spread Sahaj Yoga. Firstly, it was that they should become spirits. Before that, also there were some people who didn't actually seek the spirit. But they also became Sahaj Yogis. And I'm surprised with some of you that I never expected that they would go so far. And suddenly you hear that such and such person has gone there, has done this, has done this. So when you came into the realm of reality, I don't know which principle you accepted first. That's your understanding. But one thing you realized, that you are definitely connected with the Divine. Some people had tremendous experiences, some had mild experiences. But most of them, I saw, started believing in themselves, understanding themselves, and having confidence about themselves. Because there are so many myths about God, religion, gurus, that when they saw the light of the Spirit, which gave them sense of reality, they, as if they steadied their mind, they steadied themselves. All this happened, I must say, in a very short time. I didn't say that it took me long or I had to go through lots of various experiences. Because to me, all these experiences are nothing. If a ship is seaworthy, it can face all kinds of high tides and all kinds of sharks and everything without any difficulty, because it is seaworthy. So I didn't feel that way, but only I felt that from human level to this spiritual level, to this divine level, when you are coming, then some of that still lingers on. Some of that is still there. It has to be cleansed, it has to be brightened, we should say, or absolutely enlightened. But what was the great thing about Sahaj Yoga, that you yourself did all that. It's nice to say, Mother, you did this, you did that. Maybe enlightenment part of it. But say now there are lights here, and these lights, unless and until they are attended to, looked after, and given oil of love, how can they go on burning? This is something what I must say, that you people somehow or other realized how important it was to become good Sahaj Yogis. Maybe introspection, I don't say. Maybe somebody else talked about it. Maybe it's your own understanding. Whatever it was, all of you tried to be good Sahaja Yogis. Of course, there are people who are sometimes very angry with me, like, why don't you cure my sister, or why don't you cure my father, if you are God, this, that, is there. But makes no difference to me, because they are so frustrated, so upset, so they are talking like that. If you see one or two persons here and there, you see here thousands, such beautiful people, complete emancipation of this earth, of this globe, I'm sure will take place if you people all take up the responsibility. The responsibility has certain problems which we should know. When you feel responsible, you must know that you are not in charge. One thing. Secondly, you also must know that there are so many other forces, so many angels and ganas are with you. You are not alone. So, to think that you are doing anything will make you maybe egoistic. At that time, what you have to do is best is to say, all right, I am not doing anything, it's the Divine that is working it out. Not that the Divine wants any credit from you. But by saying that, this balloon of ego will not come up. And you will become humble. And this humility will definitely improve this great tree of spirituality within you. Definitely it will make you a very evolved personality, no doubt about it. But first of all, we have to say, I am not doing anything. It's very important to understand when you have spiritual authority to do things. It is not a testing ground, I can tell you this much. Many people think that Mother is testing us. I am not testing. You are testing yourself. I am not saying don't do this or don't do that. You are testing yourself and now must know that you are in the beautiful garden of reality. Where very few have entered. And there in that garden, when you enter, what do you see? Is everything is full of beauty. Every person has something sweet about himself. Because all other Sahaja Yogis are also having the same kind of experiences of this reality, which cannot be described in words, but you start feeling it, that oneness, that nearness, that friendship, without any expectation. You start feeling, oh, it's a Sahaja Yogi, a kind of a complete integrated organism as you become. Become an organization, I should say, which is a living organization. In that you do not feel you are something separate. any sahajogi, whether he is highly placed or he is not doing much in life, this integration, this oneness, this feeling of identification with others makes you so large, so big, so great, so powerful. You are not alone, and you say, I am not doing anything. So you become so humble that you forget all these false ideas about class consciousness or religion consciousness or all sorts of consciousness people are. I don't know much about these consciousnesses that human beings suffer from, but I've seen how it happens. And when that humility becomes your character, not that you are humble because there's something to be done. You are humble. When people are doing some sort of, say, business, they'll be extremely humble and nice, but they'll be very unkind otherwise. Here then you become absolutely humble. And there's no duality in your personality left. But that doesn't mean you become weak. Humility is only possible for people who are strong. Because they don't need any reactions. They don't need any protection. Their humility keeps them protected also very much. So you just start thinking or feeling, thinking is a funny word, feeling that you are a small dust particle. At the same time you feel you are the whole sky. It depends on where you are, what you are doing, what you are seeing, what you are witnessing. Sometimes you feel that all these big Johnnies are useless. You feel nothing to worry about them, very small. And with some people you feel you are very small. Such a flexible temperament you developed. And that makes you subtler and subtler. Because you can penetrate into anything, any subject, any personality, any understanding, any book, anything, any enterprise, in a very subtle manner, and you immediately see what is to be done. Because you become so subtle. And then when you become very great, then you start thinking, or I should say feeling, what you can do to help so many people, to do this great job, to do that. This when happens to you, they don't think that you are egoistical. Nor you should think that you are very small. Only thing is now you are the spirit. And spirit is very subtle. It's a very subtle light. But it can penetrate into anything. It can expand into anything. It can remain anywhere or it can disappear anywhere. This subtle personality that you are which is your spirit. You even don't use it, but it uses you all the time. Without your knowledge, it uses you. So the second thing should be that you should not determine what you are going to do, what I have to do. If I have decided I must do like this, whatever you have decided is all right. But if it does not materialize, there's nothing to worry. There's nothing to be upset. There's nothing to be overly nervous about. I'll give you an example. One day I was going to America. And of course, you know, as it is, as all the Sahajogis are, they get quite worried. Now mother has to go to America, see, everybody is upset. They're looking at the time, now time is this, time is that. I was just smiling. I said, I have to go to America, why are you worried? And suddenly one of the Sahajogis' child fell down and broke her hand. And she couldn't move her fingers. So I was just coming out. And as soon as he brought the child, I said, all right, I'm not going just now to the airport. They were very upset. Now she's not going to the airport, as if all the heavens are going to fall down or what. But I said, now let me see the child. I treated the child was all right. All right, I said, let's now go to the airport. And they were saying, mother, the plane must have left, it's all right, doesn't matter, let's go to the airport. Went to the airport and this plane that was going to take me was just there because there was something wrong with the plane. And there was another plane going to Washington and I wanted actually to go to Washington instead of New York. So I was in the plane nicely going to Washington. But one must know that you are not doing. Everything is arranged and planned and beautifully kept for you. You decide something, all right. If your decision is all right, if you have to do that, it will work out. If it doesn't work out, it should not have been worked out. Now this is the difference between a person who is a realized soul and who is not a realized soul. A realized soul person is not bothered what he wants, what he likes, what he is fond of. He is not. Whatever he gets is all right. Now I can see you are living under this roof which is so horrible. I mean... there's no proper arrangements here, nothing. I don't know how you are living here, I mean, I just don't know what to do. We are trying to get a land and this landowner is such a greedy fellow, but I don't mind the greed part, but still he's not yet giving us the land. It's all right, now what to do? But you all enjoy it. You don't mind. Otherwise, normally people would say, you know, I want this kind of a room and I want this kind of a house and this and that. That you can live under any circumstances because you don't worry about your physical comfort anymore. What you think of your own spiritual comfort. I've seen people, Sahajogis, so beautiful, even children. If there is a film going on, something funny comes in, immediately they all close their eyes. We don't want to see this. Nobody has to tell them because, you see, they are sort of inside, they have built in that subtle personality which cannot stand nonsense. They may not say something, they may not be harsh, but just they shun and go away from such places. automatically. So to describe the new personality is this way. That in the nature we see very clearly. In the nature what we see is a tree grows. Now it has to expand, but it cannot, so it does not. If it can, it will. And also it tries to bring all the leaves exposed to the sunlight, somehow. Now, I don't think the trees have that much intelligence to organize it. But there is something that organizes them so beautifully. Now, it's not only one tree, thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands. The one who does all that is the one with whom you are in contact. The trees are not. They are just playing into the hands of nature. But they cannot manipulate, maneuver, understand this divine power. They cannot. Animals cannot. Even human beings cannot. But you can, because you have crossed the limit of this human bondage. And now you are just like great citizens of the great realm of divinity. So this divine force helps you, works out everything. And also it takes you, it guides you, it manages you. So what you have to do is to keep yourself open for the guidance. At the same time, you must act, because the guidance will also come from within, by which you will know, this is what I have to do. Now supposing even then you feel that this was not achieved by you, and you feel that still I don't know why I couldn't get what I wanted. Try to understand that is what is the best for us. But it never means that you should give up. You should not desire. I have seen Sahaja Yogi's desires are much more powerful than mine. The reason is I am desireless. I have no desires as such. Try to see, fathom out, if I have any desires. I see I have no desires of any kind. Or I do not earnestly want anything. That you can say it's a very frivolous temperament. But it all, see, very different with you people. You people are very differently made because you have achieved something. I have not achieved anything. I am what I am. Because you have achieved something, you know how you were and what you are now. Because of your achievement, I think it is a boon that whatever you desire works out. Because you have worked so hard, it's a boon. It's a special blessing for you, whatever you desire. So many times I've told you, now don't desire anything which is not proper. Because whatever you will desire, that works out. And that will be effective. Now try to realize that you are no more ordinary human beings. You have crossed the bondage and now you are not even in the Sahasrara, you are beyond it. Sahasrara is the limbic area. And this limbic area is closed like a lotus. And when you get your kundalini entering into it, then this lotus opens like this. And that's what is written in the Bible, that I'll appear before you like tongues of flames. It's the divine saying. So these petals are nothing but nerves which are enlightened, just like these, and they look like flames. But these flames are not with any heat. They call it in Sanskrit tapahina. No heat. Extremely cooling, soothing, beautifully burning. So when this Sahasrara lotus opens, then the kundalini pierces through your fontanelle and you get your realization. This is what has happened to you. Now, only thing is to keep this lotus open. And there where we fail, sometimes, because still there are some lingering human feelings within us. Firstly, it is covered with the with the ego and the conditioning, or with the superego, two balloons. These two balloons again and again try to close the Sahasrara. So you have to be you have to be on the guard that what is closing my Sahasrara. The first is ego, which how to attack. Because you want to attack your ego, you'll have to attack through ego only. That's the only vehicle. So, we have this state of nirvichara, of thoughtless awareness, where we have to go. But the simple thing to do is very practical. Try to understand why you are being egoistical. With whom are you angry? Why are you angry? What makes you think to dominate someone or to control someone or to check someone? Why? The mind will not answer. The simple thing if you can do that whatever things that upsets you or makes you feel very great, try to understand that compared to you, nothing is greater. Compared to your love, nothing is greater. Compared to your compassion, nothing is greater. Because in this, there is the light of the divine flowing. You hate someone, you get angry with someone, just know that you have to love that person. Now, how will you love that person? There's no way to have any measurement of that. But love itself will suggest how satisfied you are feeling, how happy you are feeling. I'll give an example. The other day I received a letter from someone challenging me very much from Poland, that her mother is sick with something, cancer or something, and challenging me all the time, if you are God, you must create, cure my mother, you are, if you are God, do this, do that, do that. Very amusing. I said, all right. I put my attention to this lady. Perhaps the mother is better. But instead of getting angry, I said, she's so frustrated, she's so upset, she's so worried. Even if she says, if you are God, she's challenging me, it's all right, makes no difference. Whether she calls me God or not God, makes no difference, whatever I am. So instead of getting angry, I felt tremendous compassion for her. She's a human being, and her mother is so sick, and if that's the only source of her life, then I can understand why she is so upset. So if you just try, which you can do very easily, it's not difficult, because you are realized souls. I'm talking to saints. If you just put your attention on a person with love, then what happens? You get understanding. Understanding of that person. You realize, as if identified with that person. Then you realize, if I was in her place as a human being, what I would have felt. This desperation, this anger. If I was the same type of person with the same kind of problems, then what would I do? That solves the problem. So the identification part, you have such powers, I told you can penetrate. The identification with another is very important. And you can do it. Because you are realized souls, you can do it. Just place yourself in the same position as the other person is. And then you'll realize that you have powers of love. And identification is the only way I think one can understand love. This ego will immediately sucked in as soon as you put your loving attention on that person. In your lifetime, you will get so many experiences like that. You will be amazed at yourself, how can I do all these things? Because you are a realized soul. Also, as I said, when you are identified with another person, you put that person in charge of divinity. Just a feeling of oneness. Sometimes also we have very wrong idea about ourselves and about others. in small, small things also, we have our own ideas about something. Say, some sort of a living standards some people have, we like it. I don't like it. I like it and I don't like it. Not a saint. Saint never says that. That time when you say that, you are falsely identifying yourself with another person. For example, the one, now supposing, somebody has done such a beautiful flower arrangement. Instead of appreciating and enjoying it, if you come and say, I don't like this, this could have been better like this. I don't know why people say like that. But if you identify yourself with the man who has done it or the gentleman who has done it, you will enjoy it the way that person enjoyed it doing it. Because you are just thinking about yourself, self-opinionatedness, with which you think that this is now done so good, that could have been better, this could have been better. Who are you to judge anyone? This criticizing nature comes from a terrible misunderstanding about oneself. What are we? Why should we judge anybody else? Are we paid for it? So why waste energy on judging others? We should see what is good in others. Because in the realm of reality, it's all good, everything fine, everything first class. But if you are trying to see what's wrong with others, then you are not in reality. You can watch, you can witness, but you do not get upset with it, or you do not even say something that would upset others. You're watching it, it's all beautiful. I mean, just the joy of the person who put it, all these beautiful things, of all the persons, is just bubbling through that. But unless and until you are identified with those who have done this, you might say this should have been better, that should have been. You can be in the same position. Supposing you do something, another one will come and say, oh, you should have done it this way, that way. Wasting our energy for nothing at all. Our energy is spiritual energy. Then again you become like the sky, I told you. The greatness. We are too great to bother about these things. Wasting our energy on very, very trivial things and useless things and just making yourself small. But if this spiritual energy is used, because you can use it, you are the ones only who can manipulate it, not the trees, not the flowers, then what you will do is to create oceans of joys. So then we come to Sahaj. What has Sahaj given you is all right. But what have you given to Sahaj Yoga? What have I given to Sahaj Yoga? Have I created oceans of joys for others? What kindness I've shown, what compassion I've shown, what love I've expressed. All right, whatever Sahaj Yoga has given, we have taken it for granted. Once they come to Sahaj Yoga, they think it is a contract. already signed. And if this thing doesn't work out, then what is it? We had a contract with God, and he says, we have not been awarded fully for whatever we have paid, whatever we have done. But what have you done? In this realm of reality, have you enjoyed the reality? Have you felt the joy of this real love of divine? Are you dissolved into that, or you are still standing on the shores watching? You can create. You are quite capable of creating tremendous joy, tremendous happiness and peace. See the world today in what condition it is. It's complete turmoil, confusion, all kinds of corrupt and destructive things going on. So ugly this world has become. Can you beautify it? You can, because you can transform people. But if you are not yourself a beautiful Sahajyogi, how can you? So it is our attention on ourselves when we work out, that we have to bring others into this realm of reality. This is one side, ourselves, where we have to understand our subtleties. The another side is that we are still identified with things which we should not have been identified. We can just find out. Identified with ideas, identified with some sort of a consciousness. All these things make you really, to be very frank, they befool you. All the fools, you see, who are conditioned, are really, I don't know what to say about them, because they are like a train which has no driver. God knows when it is going to collide. Because such people who are identified, I know, now you must have seen also those who go to church, get ready nicely, go to church, sit down there, sing hymns, come home, and again quarrel and fight. But if they see a church, they'll bow. But nothing goes inside of that church. Or there are who are like, you see, you must have seen the Jews, you see, wailing, wall they have got, before that they go do all kinds of things. And what happens to them? Nothing. Same with the Muslims. They are so conditioned, I mean, cannot describe their conditioning, how stupid they are. And these conditionings go on making fool out of us. I've known so many people like that. Once in my own life, I was with some relation of mine. This gentleman used to get up at 4 o'clock. and would start singing some sort of a Rama Raksha. The whole house is sleeping, children are sleeping, he's shouting at the top. I used to say, what's the matter? Even Rama might be sleeping at this time. But he would shout, and his bathing was another thing. Everybody knew he's having a bath because he used to sing another shlokas or something. Go on. But it happened that I was in the next room, and I heard something like banging, banging, banging. I said, what's the matter? I thought he's suffering from epilepsy or what? So I rushed to other people and told them, this gentleman is suffering from epilepsy. He says, no, he doesn't suffer. I said, then why this sound come? No, he is rubbing that chandan, you know, sandalwood. And with such a big thud, every time he was putting that stone on the ground, that I thought he had epilepsy. He said, whatever you may tell him, he will never listen. He does that every day. What is this? This we understand as stupidity. When we see others, when we see human beings, but even realized souls, you are in the realm of reality. You do accept sometimes unreal things because of age-old conditionings. Your forefathers like this, his father was like this, and your forefathers' forefathers were like this. So that's still coming. They call it genes. But in Sahaja Yoga, these genes also change. So this kind of a conditioning which is lingering on still to your bodies, to your minds, to your emotions, has to be seen and cleaned out. Because that kills the joy. That kills the full experience of reality. If you want to have the full experience of the beauty of reality, then you should shed out all these things which are really befooling you momentarily. People take advantage of such people very much. As I've told you, entrepreneurs, you see, they'll start with one fashion, everybody goes like that. But we are not brainless people. Not that we have brains, but also enlightened brains. We do not take to things which are just in the fashion or which are something. We don't. What we do, we are of our own fashion. This is not ego. This is identification with your own spirit. You won't take to anything stupid and nonsensical if you have the wisdom of your spirit in you. So in the realm of reality, we have all the seven chakras absolutely enlightened, integrated and nourished. At that position, what we see is ourselves, as I said, as nothing limited, absolutely unlimited. Even when we say we penetrate, we do. When we say we expand, we do. When we contract, we do. It's absolutely a flexible personality and a personality that creates peace, joy, harmony. With the Sahasrara opening, I'm sure the whole world would be integrated. One day I will understand these problems that are facing us because of stupidity. This integration, I'm sure, will take place. And when that takes place, you'll see the life of the divine will be absolutely outshining all these darknesses or destructive forces. It's going to happen. If so many sastraras could be opened out, then why not the sastrara of this world also is opened out to truth and reality? It will. So, today, on such an important day for us, in the history of spirituality, I think this is a very important day. For us, is to realize that we are enlightened. We are the light of joy, light of compassion, light of love. Like the silent flames of the sastrara, in different colors, beautifully dancing. Then we'll know what is the enjoyment of reality is. May God bless you.